Shalom, brothers and sisters, and family.
Shalom.
Today we're going to focus on a topic. Terror. My son just kept saying, you know, because I have that southern accent. You know, we don't, you know, southern folk don't say terror. We don't match our mouths up to say things that it doesn't sound right, don't feel right to say. Terror! When the Most High say he gonna point over you terror, you know, things that terrorize you. And, you know, for us, he terrorized the heathens when we were keeping his commandments, but since we became his enemy, he is terrorizing us every day. You know, you got some, most of y'all sleep, so y'all don't even recognize you're being terrorized by the Most High. He's terrorizing y'all every day. Every time I turn on the news, somebody is getting killed by that white man. He sent that white man against you to terrorize you. Since you don't want to listen to what he got to say, okay, I'm going to point over you terror. It says Leviticus 26 and 14. I'm going to appoint like he is the Most High King, like the president, appoint all these different council members. He appointed over us terror. Y'all wondering why y'all getting killed and blowed up in the streets every day and that policeman coming in and pull you over just because you walking down the streets and grab you and put that 50,000 volts of electricity through your body because you open your darn mouth too much. Like you got all that power. If I wish you would do something, put 50,000 volts in your butt. Terror, that's what he's going to put on you. The Most High gave it to you. Now, I'm going to take this as a woosaw moment. Take this time to collect my thoughts and start my lesson. So let us begin. Let us first get to Genesis. You know, I always start in Genesis. This is the beginning of everything. 35. We're going to go through Genesis 35. 1 through 13. Genesis 35. You know, the thing about it is, even before we went into Egypt, we had a fascination with other gods. You know, we had a fascination with other gods. Even in the house of Jacob, you know, let's see what our fascination, you know, let's see what the Most High told him. Alex, read that.
And God said unto Jacob, Arise, go up to Bethel, and dwell there, and make there an altar unto God that appeared unto thee when thou fleddest from the face of Esau thy brother.
Okay, so we already know that when Jacob coerced his father Isaac out of the blessing by dressing up like Esau, putting on goat's hair, all these different attributes that Jacob did, he put on goat hair. You know, black folks got woolly hair. We never grow straight hair. He put his mother, Rebecca, help him put on goat hair on his body so that when Jacob grabbed him and felt on him, say, oh, that's Esau. Straight hair. And he smelt his garments. Smell like Esau. Been out in the woods all day. Yeah, that smelled just like Esau. So, we always trying to figure out who Esau is. We already know. All the attributes the Most High gave us, all the crumbs, he's telling us who Esau is. All right. Come on.
Then Jacob said unto his household, and to all that were with him, Put away the strange gods that are among you, and be clean, and change your garments.
Put away the strange gods. All right, come on.
and let us arise and go up to Bethel, and I will make there an altar unto God, who answered me in the day of my distress, and was with me in the way which I went. And they gave unto Jacob all the strange gods which were in their hand, and all their earrings which were in their ears. And Jacob hid them under the oak which was by Shechem. And they journeyed, and the terror of God was upon the cities that were round about them. And they did not pursue after the sons of Jacob.
Okay, you hear what they just said? See, when Jacob, our forefather, kept the commandment of the Most High God, you see what he did? He terrorized all the cities. They dared not to come out there and mess with Jacob and his family. They dared not to come out because the Most High had terrorized all of them, all the cities. But instead, since we don't want to do what he wants us to do, he placed that terror on us. Boy, I would tell you, sometimes when, you know, it, as blind as I am, I have sight. When you see things like that, and you look at people foolish, acting foolish, trying to find their salvation everywhere. The Most High God put terror on everybody because we were small in number. And, you know, you passing through the night and through the cities and stuff, people going to want to come out and meet you and fight you. The Most High God put terror on them. They were scared to even come out. All right, come on.
So Jacob came to Luz, which is in the land of Canaan, that is Bethel, he and all the people that were with him. And he built there an altar and called the place El Bethel, because there God appeared unto him when he fled from the face of his brother. But Deborah, Rebekah's nurse, died, and she was buried beneath Bethel under an oak. The name of it was called Allon-Bethah. And God appeared unto Jacob again when he came out of Padan Aram and blessed him. And God said unto him, thy name is Jacob. Thy name shall not be called any more Jacob, but Israel shall be thy name. And he called his name Israel.
So he called his name Israel in this chapter 2 in Genesis 32 and 28, he said it again. You no more Jacob, you Israel. All right, come on.
And God said unto him, I am God Almighty. Be fruitful and multiply. A nation and a company of nations shall be of thee. And kings shall come out of thy loins.
So Jacob did not know the Most High by Yahuwah, Yahweh. He knew him by El Shaddai or something like that. The God Almighty. Abraham didn't know God, the Most High God by Yahuwah. They didn't know the Most High God by that name. He's the Almighty God right here. That's what he just said, told Jacob right now. I'm the God Almighty. So they didn't know him by these names that everybody said, if you don't call this name and that name, you know, when you call his name, you're keeping his commandments. You know, my kids can call me dad all day. As long as they can keep doing what I'm doing, you know, my name ain't going to do no good when you're disobeying me. Y'all need to understand that simplicity right there. Let's get some more on this terror. Terror. Leviticus 26. You know, we always go to Leviticus 26. Every lesson I go to, you know, Leviticus 26 has an attribute of what I need to say. Leviticus 26, 14 through 19. And I just spoke into this. Leviticus 26, 14 through 19. All right, Jordan, read that.
Okay. But if ye will not hearken unto me, and will not do all these commandments, if you shall despise my statutes, or your soul abhor my judgments.
Okay, we go to pause it right there. If you despise my statutes, like a woman not wearing pants, or a man wearing a beard, or wearing fringes, or remembering the Sabbath day, or eating the dietary laws. If you despise my statutes, if you hate my judgments, you know, the Most High is making it very clear. If you decide you hate doing what he asks you to do, which most of y'all are, even the ones in Israel having problems with this book right here. The words that are on this page, they trying to make it mean something else. Let's see what the Most High say he's going to do. Continue. Jordan, continue. Okay.
So that ye will not do all my commandments.
All of them.
But that ye break my covenant.
And you breaking my covenant? Come on, what do you think you're going to do? This is an if. If you don't want to do what I told you to do, you break my covenant? What he said, Jordan?
I also will do this unto you.
I'm going to do this to you.
I will even appoint over you terrors.
These are not nice words. I'm going to appoint over you terror. And you wondering why you're getting shot down in the street and you're living in Section 8 houses and you're eating all kind of defiled foods and you got high blood pressure and low cholesterol and all kinds of craziness like that. The Most High God is terrorizing you. Why this white man won't leave you alone? Why you in prison half of your life? You don't want to do what I say, do? I'm going to point over you terror. And y'all just comfortable in this terror. This is, you know, you're stressed out all the time because you don't know if you're going to live or die. You don't know if that white man going to bust your door in the day or tomorrow. You don't know none of that. You're scared and nervous, worried about what you're going to eat because, you know, you got $20, but everything is earmarked for you. You got to get some gas. You got to do this. You got to get something to eat. And, you're worried about all this because you ain't got enough money to take care of everything. Because this here, right here, if you don't want to do my commandments and you violate my covenant? These are not nice words. I'm going to do this to you. And every time you walk out your door, you're getting terrorized. You can't walk down the street seeing a cop with your hoodie on without getting harassed and terrorized by that white man. Either y'all want to go no justice, no peace. Either one terror. That's who Most High God sent against you to do his will. Y'all gonna go complain to the person he sent against you. Boy, y'all stupid. How do you quit playing? Come on.
I will all even appoint over you terror, consumption, and the burning of.
You know, people think this is a disease. If you look in the context of what it's saying right here, the consumption and the burning og. Say the other piece.
That shall consume the eyes.
Consuming your eyes.
And cause sorrow of heart.
All of those things there. What is that referring to?
One of the dead persons
in your family. You are grieving. You are in so much grief. The sorrow of the heart. When they slay your child in front of you, and you can't do nothing. You know they gonna write it off and say, you know, as Zechariah 11:5 say, who possessor slay them and hold themselves not guilty. You already know that they ain't gonna pay. You just sorrowful and grieving because your son or your daughter is dead. Nothing you can do to bring him back. Well, we thought that hairbrush was a gun. But she was sitting on the step braiding hair. And you just came up and blew him away. Well, we sorry, you know. Wasn't nothing we could do. We told her to freeze. Well, the kill was a good kill because, you know, we told her to stop moving. Blew her away. I'm on point over you, terror. Y'all don't understand what the terror is. Walking around in your neighborhood getting terrorized. So, I just want y'all to understand the terror. Because, see, when I read it in Genesis, when Jacob was walking through all of these different heathen countries, the Most High terrorized them to the point where they didn't even want to come out and they didn't even want to see Jacob. They didn't even want to see him. Because the Most High was terrorizing all of them. But since we didn't want to do what he wanted us to do, he put that terror on us. He is terrorizing us, trying to make you wake up. He is violently shaking you up, trying to get you up. Some of y'all ain't gonna wake up. Sorry to tell you, some of y'all not gonna wake up. All right, come on, Jordan. Let's keep it moving.
Okay. And you shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemy shall eat it.
Yeah, you know what that's referring to? What is that referring to?
People
killing
yours. What?
No, you know, your kids supposed to outlive you. You sow your seeds in vain because that white man going to eat it up. He going to kill that kid, and you going to outlive your child. It's happening all over. You don't raise your child up to 16, 17, 18 years old, and you got to bury him. You know, not only the white man, we killing each other too. So you sow your seed in vain, and then somebody just come by, drive by, and shoot it. Most times, not like I said, this book is a true book. And people look at it, look, this book was written by a white man. Well, I tell you, I love my people, but some of y'all, you know, y'all need help. All right, come on, Jordan.
Okay. And I will set my face against you, and you shall be slain before your enemy.
He going to set his face against you. That means he going to turn his back. And you're going to be slain, killed, before your enemies. See, this book, in like Zechariah 11 and 5, he said that because it said right here, whose possessors slay them. You're going to be slain before your enemies. Okay, come on.
They that hate you shall reign over you.
Ain't that happening? Come on. Keep it going.
And you shall flee when none pursue it.
Oh, that's happening in the hood all the time. When that cop car roll up, little young Negroes be like deer out there, jumping the fences and, you know, jumping over rooftops, everything, gone. Be like deer and cockroaches. You don't know which was which. Because they be rolling. All right, come on.
Okay. And if ye will not yet for all this hearken unto me, then I will punish you seven times more for your sin.
So you're getting more punishment if you still not hearkening, because he said he's going to point over you terror. We already got the terror pointed over us. We already crying and people bawling their eyes out behind their kids getting killed. You raising your kids in vain because your enemy eats them up, he kills them, or they get killed before they you know, get to even realize their life. He said, after all of this, I'm going to punish you 7 times more if you don't hearken. All right, come on.
Okay. And I will break the pride of your power. And I will make your heaven as iron and your earth as brass.
And that has been done the whole entire time. Our pride. He's made our heaven as brass and our earth as iron. We have gone from generation to generation to generation in shackles. Still being used in shackles, in servitude, some kind of way or another. This white man making you work for him for free. And he not going to stop. What do he do? Put you in prison now and lease you out to all these corporations? Oh, you working for 20 cents a minute, an hour. Those jobs pay, the job that they got, the prisoners doing, they pay between $15 to $26 an hour on the outside, but they got you at 20 cents an hour. He going to get his free, he going to get his free labor out of you. You still a slave. Okay, let's get some more on this terror. Now, let's get to Deuteronomy 32, 15 through 25. Sword without and terror within. 15 through 25. I was gonna get you to read this.
But Jeshurun waxed fat and kicked. Thou art waxing fat. Thou art grown thick. Thou art covered with fatness. Thou
grown thick and covered with fatness. See, this is referring to when the Most High did give, he promised Abraham that his seeds would inhabit the land of the Canaanites and all these other people. And we just moved in. They had vineyards and everything. Houses already built. You know, we just moved in. And, you know, we got in there and we waxed fat. We waxed thick. And what do you mean when we kicked? Because when we got wealthy and the land was providing for us fully, oh, we stopped doing the commandments. We just, man, ain't got time for that. Going down here to the club, you know, get drunk and ain't going on no Sabbath. You don't have to get that. Like we doing now. You get your blessings from the Most High, and then you kick. Man, forget that. I ain't going over there no more. Got time for all that. Shoot. Come on.
Thou art grown thick. Thou art waxing. Thou art covered with fatness. Then he forsook God, which made him, and lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation.
That rock of your salvation was the Most High. So y'all lightly esteemed him. You didn't give him the praises that he deserved. All the praises for everything that you are. Come on.
They provoked him to jealousy with strange gods. With abominations provoked they him to anger.
Okay. Now, let's deal with that. They provoked him to jealousy with strange gods. Now, you guys got to understand this. Even in this captivity, we are still provoking the Most High to jealousy with strange gods. We're not worshiping the God of our father, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Most of us not. Thou shalt have, the first commandment, thou shalt have no other God before me. Name some gods they put before the Most High every year.
Christianity?
Christmas. That's a God.
Thanksgiving?
Halloween.
Samhain. Yeah, that's a God.
New Year.
Yeah, that's Saturn. That's Saturn. What's the God? Janus, the God of Janus. Janus is New Year's. That's a God. The God of beginnings, new beginnings, and past. That New Year's resolution, that's the God of Janus.
Easter,
yeah, that's Ishtar and Astari and all of that. Astari and, Ishtar, Babylonian. All of these are the gods that we place before the Most High year in and year out. We don't know our Most High God. You know, you people claim that they know the Most High God, but they don't. They go into these churches on the wrong day. Don't even know when the Sabbath day is. Now, how can you be worshiping the God of this Bible when you're not doing anything he asks you to do? Because the first four commandments are truly about him. He don't want no gods before him. He don't want you bowing down to any images. Don't make no graven images. He wants you to remember his Sabbath day. Those four commandments y'all violate every week. The Sabbath day. Walk around that Christianity cross on your neck. That's like walking around with the lethal injection around your neck now. That was the Roman execution. That's how they executed people during that time. So if you want to start wearing it, you know, the needle or the lethal injection needles or whatever around your neck, or a noose where, you know, they hanging black people all the time, you know, that's what that cross represents. I don't see y'all walking around with nooses around your neck when the white man hang you. That's just foolishness. You don't know your Elohim. All right, come on. Your rock.
They provoked him to jealousy with strange gods. With abominations provoked they him to anger. They sacrificed them to devils, not to God. The gods whom they knew not.
Okay, you sacrifice it to devils. Samhain is a devil. Saturnella, those devils. You don't even, you know, to new gods. We didn't know these gods. Come on.
Okay. They sacrificed unto devils, not the God. The gods whom they knew not. The new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not.
Christianity and Islam, we didn't know them. We didn't know those gods. Allah, we didn't know nothing about no Allah. Come on.
Of the rock that begat thee, thou art unmindful.
We don't know him.
And hath forgotten God that formed thee. And when the Lord saw it, he abhorred them, because of the provoking of his sons and of his daughters. And he said, I will hide my face from them.
He hid his face from us. And he allowed all of the stuff that is being done to us, because that's part of his hiding his face. He turned his back on us. He ain't listening to you. He allowing all of these captivities and all of this slavery and all of this junk that we're going through. He hid his face because we don't know him no more. All right, come on. Come on.
Okay. I will see what their end shall be, for they are a very forward generation, children in whom is no faith. They have moved me to jealousy with that which is not God. They have provoked me to anger with their vanities, and I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people. I'll provoke them to anger with a foolish nation.
Oh, he provoked us to jealousy with a foolish nation. I wonder what nation that is. All right, come on.
For a fire is kindled in mine anger, and shall burn into the lowest hell, and shall consume the earth with her increase, and set on fire the foundations of the mountains. I will heap mischiefs upon them. I will spend mine arrows upon them.
Okay. His mischiefs, all of the slaveries, you know, the pig laws, you know, all of the different southern states had different pig laws.
What's a pig law?
It was laws that were, you know, if you walked along the side of a railroad track, they put you in jail. That became like a felony back then when they let you go. So what they would do is arrest you, put you in jail, give you long prison sentences for the smallest of crimes, and they sell you back to your slave master, that plantation owner. Jim Crow laws, you know. No, black codes at first, then Jim Crow. All right, come on.
Okay. They shall be burned with hunger and devoured with burning heat and with bitter destruction. I will also send them teeth, the beast, upon them with the poisonous serpents of the dust, the sword without and terror within, to destroy both the young man and the virgin, the suckling also with the man of gray hairs.
Like I'm saying, the sword without and terror within. Who's killing us outside?
Esau.
You know, you're getting blown away, and then who's terrorizing us within our own communities?
God.
No, we terrorizing ourselves. Drug dealers and gangsters and all this kind of mess. You know, they're killing everybody. You got to walk very softly around these kind of people. These people that's terrorizing you in your own community. You got to walk softly around them. You can't say nothing that they disagree with, because you don't know what they're going to do to you. They mess around and pull out a gun and shoot you just for saying that, hey, man, you know, you don't supposed to do that right there. You know, come on.
I'm done with the 15:25.
Oh, okay. Let's move on. Okay, we're going to move to 34, 1 through 11.
What?
Deuteronomy 34, 1 through 11. And this is to show you that, you know, there was no prophet like unto Moses. No prophet like unto Moses. So, with that said, well, was the Messiah a prophet?
Yes.
No.
Wait, no.
He was a savior. He is the Messiah. He was the savior. He had properties of a prophet, but he was not a prophet. Okay. All right, come on. Jordan, I want you to read this.
Okay. Moses went up from the plains of Moab into the mountain of Nebo, to the top of Pisgah that is over against Jericho. And the Lord showed him all the land of Gilead unto Dan, and all Naphtali, and all of Ephraim, and Manasseh, and the land of Judah unto the utmost sea, in the south, in the plain of the valley of Jericho, the plain, the city of palm trees, unto Zor. And the Lord said unto him, this, the land which I swear unto Abraham.
Now, see, all of this time, this was about the promise that the Most High gave to Abraham. He gave Abraham a promise, but unto us he gave an inheritance of, by the law. All right, come on.
I swear unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob, saying, I will give it unto thy seed. I have caused thee to see it with thine eyes, but thou shalt not go over thither. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, according to the word of the Lord.
So Moses didn't get this step one foot into the promised land that was sworn unto the Israelites. All right, come on.
And he buried him in the valley in the land of Moab, over against Beth Peor. But no man knoweth of his sepulture unto this day. And Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eye was not dim, nor his natural force abated. And the children of Israel wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days. The days of weeping and mourning for Moses were ended. And Joshua, the son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands upon him, and the children of Israel hearkened unto him. And he did as the Lord commanded Moses. And there arose not a prophet since in Israel like unto Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face.
So there was no other prophet like Moses. The Most High God knew Moses face to face. Now, Moses didn't see him face to face because no man can see the Most High, but he did, you know, walk past him and he saw his backside, because if you know, the Most High got so much power in his face that any man see him would die. And he told Moses that. All right, come on.
And all the signs and the wonders which the Lord sent him to do in the land of Egypt to Pharaoh, and to all the servants, and to all his land, and all that mighty hand, and all the great terror which Moses showed in the sight of Israel.
Of all Israel. Moses showed all the terrors of the Most High that he was putting on the other nations when he was establishing us as his people. He terrorized the other nations. And when he gave us the law, and he told us, if you don't obey my law and you despise my commandments and you break my covenant, the terror that he placed on the other nations, he placed on us. Y'all got to realize that's what we are going through right now. It's a terror from the Most High. Think about everything you're going through right now. Joshua 2. We're going to talk about Rahab the harlot, because this is good for you guys to know.
And? Joshua 2 is what?
It's 1 through 14. Then it's 17 through 21. Then we're going to jump down to Joshua 6 and 17. And then Joshua 6 and 23. This is all in Rahab the harlot.
6 and 17 and 6 and 23.
Okay. Okay. So we're going to go through Rahab the harlot. Joshua 2, 1 through 4. 1 through 14. All right, I'll just read that.
Okay. And Joshua, the son of Nun, sent out of Shittim two men to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, even Jericho. And they went and came into a harlot's house named Rahab and lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, there came men in hither tonight of the children of Israel to search out the country. And the king of Jericho sent unto Rahab, saying, bring forth the men that have come to thee, which are entered into thine house, for they be come to search out all the country. And the woman took the two men, and hid them, and said thus, there came men unto me, but I wist not whence they were. And it came to pass about the time of shutting of the gate, when it was dark, that the men went out. Whither the men went, I wot not. Pursue after them quickly, for ye shall overtake them. For she had brought them up to the roof of the house, and hid them with the stalks of flax, which she had laid in order upon the roof. And the men pursued after them the way to Jordan, unto the fords. And as soon as they which pursued after them were gone out, they shut the gate. And before they were laid down, she came up unto them upon the roof. And she said unto the men, I know that the Lord hath given you the land, that you, your terror is fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you.
Okay. She said, the terror is fallen upon us. That means the Most High God was terrorizing all of them just for the children of Israel. Continue to listen to what she said. Verse 10. Continue.
For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when ye came out of Egypt, and what ye did unto the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side, Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom ye utterly destroyed.
We were famous. They knew about us. They knew that we had a living God. This was Rahab, the harlot. She like, I know the Lord is with you, and he's terrorizing the land around us, round about us. Come on. Okay.
And as soon as we had heard these things, our hearts did melt. Neither did there remain any more courage in any man.
That's what terror does to you. It just, we ain't got no shot. Hearts melt. We ain't got a chance. Okay, come on.
For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and in earth beneath.
She didn't say our God. She said the Lord your God. Rahab the harlot knew that the Most High God was our God.
Now therefore, I pray you, swear unto me by the Lord, since I have showed you kindness, that ye will also show kindness unto my father's house, and give me a true token, that ye will save alive my father, and my mother, my brethren, and my sisters, and all that they have, and deliver our lives from death. And the man answered her, our life for yours, if ye utter not this our business. And it shall be, when the Lord hath given us the land, that we will deal kindly and truly with thee.
So, they promised her, like, you know, okay, if you don't utter our business, okay, we'll do that. We'll save you and your father and your family. She already knew. She was cutting a deal. She said, look, if you save my family, you know, because of all of the kindness I did, you know, I'm asking you to save my family. Because of the kindness I did for you, I hid y'all out. All right, go jump down to 17. Let's see what that deal entailed, because it was very, because, you know, the men of Israel didn't just say, all right, and they were going to be responsible. Say, for instance, when they took over the city and one of her relatives went out there in the streets and, hey, what's going on? The next thing, he got his head blown off or got his head shot off by an arrow or got burnt up or something. One of the other Israelite brothers didn't know who he was.
And the men said unto her, we will be blameless of this thine oath, which thou hast made us swear. Behold, when we come into this land, thou shalt bind this line of scarlet thread in the window which thou didst let us down by. And thou shalt bring thy father and thy mother and thy brethren and all thy father's household home unto thee. And it shall be that whosoever shall go out of the doors of thy house into the street, his blood shall be upon his head.
If he goes, you take, if anybody leave your house. Now, you tie this string, so don't let every all the Israelites know that this is your house and we made a contract with you. But if your family decide they want to go outside and take a peek, you know, and do something else, that blood is on their hand. We ain't responsible for them. All right, come on.
And we will be guiltless, and whosoever shall be with thee in the house, his blood shall be on our head. if any hand be upon him. And if thou utter this our business, then we will be quit of thine oath, which thou hast made us to swear.
So he's saying, they're acknowledging two things. Three things. If your family goes out in the streets, they blood on their hand. Now, if somebody touches your family while they're in this house, the blood is on our hand. And what else? If you utter our business, this contract is void. There is no more contract. If you tell our business, this contract is void. Basically, what he's saying. Okay. All right. Did I say 21? Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, go ahead.
And she said, according unto your words, so be it. And she sent them away, and they departed. And she found the scarlet line in the window.
Okay, so we're gonna go to Joshua 6 and 17 to verify that. To verify that they keep their oath.
Joshua 6 and 17?
And Joshua 6 and 23, come on. Okay. Dominic, I want you to read that. 6 and 17 and 6 and 23.
And the city shall be a curse, even it, and all that are therein, to the Lord. Only Rehab, the harlot, shall live, she and all that are with her in the house. For she is the messenger that we
sin. So, they acknowledged that. Let's go to the 23rd of verse.
Okay. And the young men that were spies went in and brought out Rehab and her father and her mother and her brethren and all that she had. And they brought out all of her kindred and left them without the camp of Israel.
So they brought all of Rahab, her family, and left them without. They didn't become Israelites because she saved them. They still weren't, they weren't allowed in the camp. They left them without the camp of Israel, outside of the camp. So they camped on the outer portion of where the Israelites were camping. But they were a part of the Israelite family from then on. They were not the leaders. Okay, so people get Rahab became an Israelite. No, Rahab didn't become an Israelite. See, they left her outside of the camp. She wasn't an Israelite, so she wasn't permitted to come inside of the camp. Okay, this is a. Let's get this one here is very important. Job 31, and this is 7 through 23. Job 31. Let's see what Job says. We go 7 through 23. Jordan, you there?
No.
Job 31, 7, verses 7 through 23.
Okay. If my step hath turned out of the way, and my heart walked after mine eyes.
So my heart, my mind, walked after what I see. Okay, come on.
And if any blot has cleaved to mine hands.
Oh, any blot had cleaved to my hand. Any error, any sin. Okay, come on.
Then let me sow, and let another eat. Yea, let my offspring be rooted out.
Let my offsprings be rooted out. you know, Job is saying, if you could tell he's a righteous man. He like, if my heart walked after my eyes, which we all do, right? Which we all do in this day and time. Everybody's mind walking after their eyes. Everything they see, they lust after. Job say, I'm not walking that way. Come on.
If mine heart have been deceived by a woman, or I have laid wait at my neighbor's door.
He's talking about fornication and adultery.
Then let my wife grind unto another's.
Let my wife grind unto another. You know what that means? Have sex with somebody else.
And let others bow down upon her. For this is a heinous crime. Yea, it is an iniquity to be punished by the judges.
Yeah, it's a heinous crime to commit fornication. To be punished by the judges. That's why the Most High God said, ye are gods, because we judges is another word for gods. During this time. Come on.
Okay. For as a fire that consumeth to do destruction, it would root out all mine increase. For I did despise the cause of my manservant or my maidservant when they contended with me. What then shall I do when God riseth up? And when he visiteth, what shall I answer him? Did not he that made him in the womb make him?
He that made me in the womb make him? So did the Most High God that made me in the womb make also my manservant? Come on.
If I have withheld the poor from their desire, or have caused the eyes of the widow to fill, or have eaten my morsel myself alone, and the fatherless hath not eaten thereof, for with my youth he was brought up with me, as with a father, and I have guided her from my mother's womb. If I have seen any perish for want of clothing, or any poor without covering, if his loins have not blessed me, and if he were not warmed with the fleece of my sheep, if I have lifted up my hand against the fatherless, when I saw help in the gate, then let mine arm fall from my shoulder blade, and my arm be broken from the bone. For destruction from God was a terror to me, and by reason of his highness, I cannot endure.
So, the destruction... See, I'm going to show you a scripture that basically is saying this in just one verse. Psalms 111. Psalms 111. Somebody gonna let you read this. In 10. Yeah. Psalms 111 and 10.
Okay. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding of all they that do his commandments.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do his commandments. This is basically what Job is saying from 7 to 23. He feared sin because he fears the judgment of the Most High. At the end, he says, what? For destruction from God was a terror to me. You know, he didn't want to be terrorized by the Most High God. Some of y'all don't care. Y'all being terrorized every day and don't even know it. Job was like, I do not want to be terrorized by the Most High God. He had wisdom. He had a good understanding. He didn't even want to do harm to his manservant, the person working for him. Because he said, didn't the Most High God make him like he made me in the womb? He didn't want to even do bad to the manservant. You know, He didn't sin by his heart falling after his eyes. Like 99.9% of Israelites today, that's how we live. We got a long way to get to the third, the one third. But the majority of these people live by what their eyes see. That's what they seeing is. He understood the judgments of the Most High, the terrors of the Most High. I'm just trying to get y'all to understand the terror of the Most High, because apparently you guys don't. Psalms 91, 1 through 11.
Psalms
91, 1 through 11.
Go back.
Not be afraid for the terror by night. Give me some water now, please. Okay. Let's get to Psalms 91, 1 through 11. Thank you, Jordan. Okay. Alex, I'm gonna let you.
You say that again?
91, 1 through 11. Psalms
91, 1 through 11. Okay. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord.
Okay, now, understand what that means. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Understand what that means. Jordan, give it a hit. Just think how you dwell in the secret place of the Most High. Wow, that's quick and efficient. Very thoughtful. That's a good one, Jordan. Because the secret place of the Most High is where His Word lies.
The book?
This book is His secret place. You know, this book is His secret place. This is His secret place. Y'all don't understand the secrets in this book that's hidden from in plain sight from a lot of people. You're not going to see these secrets unless you're keeping His commandments. You dwelling in His secret place, you abiding in His shadow of the Almighty. All right, come on.
I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, and Him will I trust.
So, if you are trusting the Most High God, He is your fortress. He protects you. He protects you from all your enemies, from the people that want to do harm to you, that planning to do harm. Everything going to fail that they do. If the Most High God is with you, there is nobody that's going to be able to stand against you. All right, come on.
Surely He will shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler, and from the noisome pestilence.
Oh, I missed a few scriptures. Okay, we got a few precepts. Let's go to Proverbs 3:5-7 for Proverbs 3:5-7. Proverbs 3. All right.
Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil.
Fear the Lord and depart from evil. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart, and lean not unto your own understanding. That's lying in the shadow. You dwelling in the secret place of the Most High. You trust in him with all your heart. You're not leaning to your own understanding. He, you know, Satan saying that he's my refuge and he is my fortress, because you trust my God, in him will I trust. You're not leaning to your own understanding. You are following the commandments in this book. This is his secret place. You are dwelling in his secret place because he is revealing secrets to you, and others, they don't get these secrets. This is his secret place right here. All right, come on. Verse 3, surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler. What's a fowler?
It's a bird.
Fowler.
The snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence.
The trout?
Yeah, the fowler is a bird catcher. Let's see who the fowlers are. Jeremiah 12:9. Let's stay right here, but we're going to come back. Let's get to Jeremiah 12:9 first. Get a precept for that scripture. Jeremiah 12:9. Jeremiah 12:9.
My heritage is unto me as a speckled bird.
My heritage. Who's the Most High God's heritage?
Israel.
Israel. We're like speckled birds. Fowler. Bird catcher. Now, bird catcher. Now, Most High God just referenced us as birds right here. Who is the fowler?
Esau.
Our enemies. Not only Esau. Okay, come on. Continue reading that.
The birds round about are against her.
Those are the fowlers. All the birds around about are trying to catch them up in traps and stuff. Come on.
Come ye, assemble all the beasts of the field. Come to devour.
They come to devour. And like I'm saying, they all around about you, they are the catchers. That's what a fowler is. They catches up in traps. Every time that white man pull you over, he's a fowler. Because the Most High God is equating us to speckled birds, because we're all different types, colors, even in our own family. We're like speckled birds amongst our own family. So we are the birds, and the enemies is the fowler coming to prey upon you. And that noisy pestilence, all these different diseases that you get caught up in. Come on.
He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day.
For the terror by night. No, you know, who is this? This is Asaph of David. But now, what was he talking about? The terror by night.
Night terrors.
Nightmares?
The terror by night?
A robber?
What goes on in darkness?
Killings?
All kinds of stuff. Sin in particular. Thou should not be afraid for the terror by night.
Kobe?
Nor for the arrow that flyeth by day. All the missiles flying by day. So you're not going to be afraid of that. Why? Because
you're not going to see it.
God has protection
over refer to verse 1. Read verse 1 again.
He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High.
If you're keeping the commandments.
Shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty.
And he's going to be your fortress and protect you against all of this stuff. Against those fowlers who are trying to trap you up. And all these fowlers are doing all of this. The terrors by night. Setting up traps by night, breaking in and coming in and doing all kinds of craziness, and the arrows that fly by day. Come on.
Nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness.
Pestilence that walketh in darkness. Does a pestilence walk by itself in darkness? No.
What's a pestilence?
Some disease and Mom, look at pestilence. Pestilence that walk in darkness. Pestilence doesn't walk by in the darkness by themselves.
Pestilence.
Name some pestilence, some diseases.
Flu?
AIDS.
That walk. Name another one. All kind of STDs. You know why it's walking in darkness?
Because it happens under the sun.
It happens at night.
Proverbs 21:16. No, Proverbs 21:16. Okay, look at pestilence.
Pestilence. A fatal epidemic disease, especially bubonic plague.
Okay. Now, that's the white man's term, but pestilence, you know, walking in darkness. Pestilence walking in darkness.
The man that wandered out of the way of understanding shall remain in the congregation of the dead.
You're in darkness. So if you're committing sin, you're whoremongering, fornicating, doing all kinds of different the things. You're not going to, what it said, nor for the pestilence that walking in darkness. Because if you are keeping the Most High God's commandment, you're eating properly, you're not eating unclean foods, you're not a whoremonger, you're not subjecting yourself, your spouse, everybody in line to sexually transmitted diseases. That's a pestilence walking in darkness, because the person walking in darkness is the one that has the potential for all of these different pestilence. Y'all, like I'm saying, these are the terrors that the Most High God put on you and you don't even know it. These are his terrors. He got you. He's trapping you everywhere you go. That woman you getting with, oh, she fly, she fine, she this, she that. And she just found out that she had AIDS, and she running around giving it to everybody in the damn community. Oh, you don't need no condom. Next thing you know, you got AIDS. The woman that you dealing with got AIDS, and everybody else around you got AIDS. Find out your homeboy got AIDS because he's sleeping with your girlfriend. Oh, I'm gonna tell you, that's how things go. Okay. All right, come on, verse 7.
Psalms 91, right?
Yeah, 7.
Okay.
What's what are we going to do right now?
I need to finish 6. Nor for the destruction that wasted at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee.
Let's verify that. Isaiah 66. And 16. We're going to jump back here. Isaiah 66 and 16.
Just turn it down. For by fire and by his sword will the Lord plead with all flesh, and the slain of the Lord shall be many.
People are going to be dropping by you like flies. You keeping the commandment? Oh, there another 100 of them dropped over there. Oh, man, a couple thousand over there. Most High God said that nothing going to touch you. If you are keeping his commandments, you are walking in his shadow. He is not going to allow anything to come near you, touch you. What he said, 1,000
shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee.
It's not going to come near you. And like I'm saying, I tell people all the time, all this, you better get your canteens and your food supply. Yeah, you know, I'll bite, you know, just in case we have a outage or something. You know, I want to have some, you know, propane and some stuff like that so I can grill outside, maybe some logs and something so I can barbecue or whatever. But all this other stuff, Most High got my back. I'm going to keep his commandments, and then I'm going to tell you like this. I ain't worried about all y'all. Like I said, because y'all worried what man can do, what we need to do. No. I have a God behind me. I'm not worried about, you know, something that man has planned. I have an almighty Elohim. And I suggest you guys, if you trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding, you'll start jumping in line too. Trusting your God. He ain't gonna let you down. He ain't gonna let you go. All right, come on. Okay.
Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked.
So you're gonna look. You're gonna see the reward of the wicked being slain in your right hand and on your left.
Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation.
So you living in his sanctuary and living in his laws and his statutes and his commandments.
There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling.
So no evil nor plagues come near your household, your dwellings, where you live. Come on.
For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways.
His angel is there watching over you. This is his word. Most High don't lie. Y'all do. He ain't never lied to me. And his words are true as they were yesterday when I read it yesterday. I read this yesterday or the day before. I believed it then, still believe it. Isaiah. We're going to start at 33 and 1, then we're going to do 10 through 18. Woe to the spoilers, and when you were not spoiled.
33 and 1, Jordan, and 10 through 18.
Woe to thee that spoilest, and thou wast that spoilest. Okay, woe to you that spoilest, and you weren't spoiled. Nobody didn't come in and spoil you or make war against you. Woe to thee that spoilest, and thou wast not spoiled. Okay?
And dealest treachery.
Treacherously, yeah. Woe to y'all that dealest treacherously.
And they deal not treachery with thee.
And they didn't deal treacherously with you. Come on.
When thou shalt seize the spoil, thou shalt be spoiled.
When you start spoiling, you're going to get spoiled. Come on.
And when thou shall make an ending to deal treacherously. They shall deal treacherously with thee.
That when you make an end to dealing treacherously, they're going to deal treacherously with you. Okay, I'm going to tell you. I'm going to find two precepts in the Bible that says something similar. Let's go to Obadiah.
Obadiah.
Obadiah
what?
Verse 15.
For the days of the Lord is near upon all the heathen. As thou hast done, it shall be done upon unto thee.
As you don't did, it's going to be done unto you. You dealt treacherously, so they're going to deal treacherously with you.
Thy reward shall return upon thine own head.
All the stuff you've been doing, you are spoilers when you weren't spoiled. When you are... spoiling people and enslaving them and putting them in prison and making them work for free. It's going to be done unto you. Let's see that. Let's read that again. Revelation 13, verse 10.
Any man have an ear. Let him hear.
Okay, he ain't saying if you got ears. Hold up.
He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity.
Now, if he said, if any man have an ear, let him hear. He not saying, okay, you don't have ears. He's saying, if you got understanding, let you hear. He that leadeth into captivity. Come on.
Shall go into captivity.
Okay, what he saying?
He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity.
Okay, if thou dealt, okay. Woe to them that spoilest, and thou wast not spoiled, and dealest treacherously, when they dealt not treacherously with thee. And when he said the end, and when thou shalt make an end to deal treacherously, they shall deal treacherously with thee. So you that leadeth into captivity dealt treacherously. Shall go into captivity. You're going to be dealt treacherously with too. He that killeth. Okay, come on.
He that killeth with the sword.
You dealt treacherously.
Must be killed with the sword.
They're going to deal treacherously with you.
Here is the patience and the faith. And the faith of the saints.
And we all know the saints are the Israelites according to what?
Psalms 148:13-14.
138:14, the saints are the Israelites. Here are the patience of the saints. Okay, so let us continue on at Isaiah 30:31. Alex, you go. Jordan, I want you to do 10 through 31. Did Alex, you just finish reading?
10 through 18, yes, I just finished reading.
10 through 18, Jordan.
Okay. Now will I rise, saith the Lord. Now will I be exalted. Now will I lift up myself. Yea shall conceive chaff. Yea shall bring forth stubble. Your breath, as fire, shall devour you.
Okay, so he's saying, I'm finna turn you into stubble, and fire gonna consume you. Come on.
And the people shall be burnings of lime.
As the burnings of lime.
As thorns cut up, shall they be burned in the fire.
They burst in the fire. As thorns cut up, shall they be burst in the fire. So the Most High say, he rising up to consume some people. Come on.
Okay. Hear ye that are far off what I have done. And ye that are near, acknowledge my might.
Acknowledge my might. Come on.
The sinners in Zion are afraid.
The sinners in Zion. What is that referencing to?
The sinners in America?
Zion. Israel.
The Israelite.
I mean, the Gentiles.
The sinners in Zion. That's Israel.
Okay.
this relationship.
Not the southern, I mean the northern kingdom.
Mm-mm. We're talking about let's go to Zechariah 13 and 8. Come on, Jordan, go come back there, so don't lose your spot.
Zechariah what?
13 and 8.
Right in there.
Let me read that.
And it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die.
Those are sinners in Zion. That's two-thirds.
But the third part, the third shall be left therein.
Yeah, those are the sinners that are going to be afraid. Come on. Those are the sinners that's going to be afraid in Zion. Come on, George.
Fearfulness has surprised the hypocrite.
Read that again, 14.
The sinners in Zion are afraid. Fearfulness has surprised the hypocrites.
The fearfulness. They're scared. They're hypocrites because they are preaching. They're saying one thing and doing the opposite. Come on.
Who among us shall dwell with the devouring fire?
Who gonna be cast into hell? Come on.
Who among us shall dwell with everlasting burning?
Who gonna get cast into hell? Come on.
He that walketh righteously and speaketh uprightly, he that despiseth the gain of oppressions, that shaketh his hands from holding of bribe, and stoppeth his ears from hearing of blood, and shutteth his eyes from seeing evil, he shall dwell on high. His place of deep defense shall be the munition of rocks.
All right, I want y'all to evaluate verse 15. Because those are the righteous ones. Those are the ones that's going to be living up high in the kingdom. On high in the kingdom. If this is you, you're going to be in the kingdom. Because the Most High just said it. So, if that's not you, you walking righteously, and you know what righteously is, you keeping the law, following the commandments. And speak it uprightly, commandments. He that despises the gain of oppressions, you know, gains of oppression. You're oppressing somebody and making money. This white man has been putting us in slavery forever. We got 400 years or more we got almost 400 years of bondage. One slavery after another. And shaketh his hands from holding of bribes, that stopped his ears from hearing of blood, and shut his eyes from seeing evil. Nobody want to be devin' in evil, you know, but we got people that be on the boundary, you know, they ain't the one that pulled the trigger, but they know what a dead body is, type of people. Y'all gonna be cast in hell too. Because, you know, it's not... Because you're not shunning evil. You're hanging around evil. You want to do evil, but you don't have that kind of fortitude to pull a trigger and kill somebody. But you know people that do. So you know what a dead body is. You don't wear and look at it. Oh, my God. You know. You shot his head off. You know, and you come in about it. See, you know, you shouldn't want to be seeing evil, shunning it, and doing it. And you shouldn't want to be seeing it. Okay, now if that's not you, okay, well, that you're going to be having an eternal burning. Because when the Most High God says when he rises up, when he stands up, it's going to be burning. And see, the thing about it is, he said Zion. The sinners in Zion, in verse 14. He addressing his people. Okay, come on.
Okay, 16. He shall dwell on high. His place of defense shall be the munitions of rocks. Bread shall be given him. His water shall be sure.
Bread will be given him. His food is going to be given him. That means he ain't preparing his own food. His bread given him. What that mean?
That he's getting... He has servants?
Wow. That's what that mean. Because you're going to have others working for you. Your bread is going to be given to you. You ain't going to be fixing your plate. You're going to be sitting down at the table. Master. Master Steve, your food is done.
Master.
All right, I'll be right in. Thank you. Did you call my wife to come in and eat?
Too much.
You know. My bread is going to be given to me, and my water is sure. And its waters shall be sure. All right, come on.
Okay. Thine eyes shall be see the king and his beauty. They shall behold the land that is very far off. That is very far off. Thine heart shall meditate terror. Where is the scribe? Where is the receiver? Where is he that counted the towers?
Where he at? See, these are the scriptures that you need to meditate on day and night. Because, yeah, the Most High is coming again. He's coming again, and his final terror is to deliver the children of Israel who are keeping his commandments. Now, you people that are not keeping the Most High God commandments, because you're Israelite, doesn't it fault you into the kingdom? You don't get in by default. You got to be doing the commandments. Having patience. Okay. Let's go to Isaiah 34. 4 through 9, and then we're gonna jump to 14 through 17.
Can I read this?
Yes. I think 4 through 9.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You said that like 5 times.
You said that like 5 times.
Did you do something wrong?
No. All right, 4 through 9. And then when I say it, 14 through 17. All right. No, no, it gets a little bit too much.
Okay, can I read the 4 through 9 part?
All right, go read 4 through 9 then.
And all the hosts of heaven shall be dissolved, and the heaven shall be rolled together as a scroll, and of all their hosts together as a scroll. All their hosts shall fall down, as the leaf fall off from the vine.
Okay, so we're talking about the destruction. That's a nuclear bomb. And all the host of heaven shall be dissolved, and the heaven shall be rolled together as a scroll. That's one of them nuclear mushroom clouds, when it rolls as a scroll. And all their hosts shall fall down as the leaf falleth off from the vine. Come on.
For my sword shall be bathed and heaved, Behold, it shall come down upon Edomia. And upon the
people. Upon who?
Edomia.
Upon Edomia. Now, anybody want to tell me who Edomia is?
Esau.
Okay. We know it's Esau, but why? Because Esau.
It's Greek for red.
Okay. It's a Roman and Greek term for red. For Edom. It's the Roman and Greek term for. All right. Let's. All right, Dominic, you continue to read.
Okay, let me get there. The sword of the Lord is filled with blood. It is made fat with fatness, and with the blood of lambs and goats, with the fat of kidneys of rams. For the Lord hath sacrificed in Boraz, in the great slaughter in the land of Idumea.
So the Most High is going to have a great slaughter in the land of Idumea. This has been in the Bible for forever. This was written thousands of years ago. You know, come on, let's continue.
And the unicorns shall come down with them, and the bullets with the bulls, and their lands shall be soaked with blood, and their dust made fat with fatness.
And the dust made fat with fatness. What is, was that it?
No, we have to get to 9.
Okay, go ahead.
For it is the day of the Lord's vengeance, and the year of recompense for the controversy of Zion.
For the controversy of Zion. That's when the Most High God's coming to pay back Edom for the controversy with Zion. Because what is the controversy with Zion?
The differences?
What's the controversy on the earth today?
They're the least of the earth?
No, who says that they are the Zion? They are a Zion.
Oh. White man saying
that? You know, we got other people saying that they are a Jews and of, you know, the Zionists and all this. They got our doctrine and they don't twist it up with all kinds of crap. You know, they got the feast days all on the wrong day. I don't know what Bible they're reading, but you know, this is October and they just talking about the Day of Atonement. And the Day of Atonement is in the 7th month. And they just doing the Day of Atonement, the Feast of Tabernacles in October. And that's supposed to be in the 7th month. I'm trying to understand what they're coming from. So that controversy with Zion. Come on.
And the streams thereof shall be turned into pitch, and the dust thereof into brimstone, and the land thereof shall become burning pitch.
It's going to burn up. So their land is going to be burnt. It's going to be fire and brimstone. That nuclear explosion, that's what's going to kill them. Okay. Okay.
Keep reading.
All right. Verse 14. Go ahead and read 14 through 17.
The wild beast of the desert shall also meet with the wild beast of the island. And the satyr shall cry of all of his fellow. The screech owl also shall rest there. and find for herself a place to rest. There shall the great owl make her nest, and lay, and hatch, and gather under the shadow. There shall the vultures also be gathered, every one with every mate, with her mate. Seek ye out the book of the Lord, and read. No one of these shall fail. None shall want her mate.
So, this verse here, verse 34 and 16, Isaiah 34 and 16, seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. None of these shall fail, and none shall want her mate. None of these prophecies is going to fail you. This Bible does not need a mate. It doesn't need no other book to validate it. Now, you can get history books to check. It's going to tell you that these prophecies happened. Like us going into slavery on slave ships. There are a lot of people who wrote books about us in the captivity that we've been in. There have been a lot of people that wrote books about that. A lot of people wrote books about, you know, our sons and daughters being given and sold to other people. You know, being sold on auction blocks. Now, this white man has not, you know, been truthful about. This white man has not been truthful about slave owners that did exist, but they were still putting us in bondage back in the 1900s. They would sell us to the slave plantation owners. I came across a PBS on the public broadcasting system network a documentary called let me find out what it's called. It's called Slavery by Another Name. Slavery by Another Name on Public Broadcasting Network. It's historical. It has dates. It has shows how these systems, you know, the justice system, the police was chopping up charges against our ancestors, putting them in jail for small crimes and giving them long sentences and selling them off to the plantation owner to do work. Every time during cotton season when it need to be picked, they go out and basically just hoard up black folks and put them in jail just to pick cotton for Master Charles. Still, he getting his free labor. We never been free in this country. And I just want y'all to understand that shadow of freedom, you're not free. And the Most High is still terrorizing you because you are wicked. You want to be like this white man. You want to follow all of his practices and ways. Let me see. But I'm going to show you. It's not in my lesson plan, but I'm going to show you how we ended up being like the white man. How his system started on us. Let's go to 2 Maccabees, chapter 4. Going through 9 through 16.
9 through 16.
Mm-hmm. This is one of the so-called priests during the time that his name was Jason, and he was getting with the Greeks. All right, read.
Besides this, he promised to assign 150 more. if he might have license to set him up a place for exercise.
Oh, he go set up him a gym. You know, gymnasium was like a place, I think it's called place of nudity. That's what, you know, because they used to work out in the nude, in these gyms, place of exercise. So the...
And for the training up of youth in the fashions of the heathen.
Fashion of the heathen. Train them up to do what?
And to write them by Jerusalem by the name of Antiochians.
Okay, call them the Antiochians. That was the people in the Jerusalem. Their team was called the Antiochians after King Antiochus.
Which when the king had granted and he had gotten into his hand the rule, he forthwith brought his own nation to the Greekish fashion.
So Jason brought his nation, brought the Israelites into the Greekish fashion. Come on, let's go.
And the royal privileges granted of special favor to the Jews by the means of John the father, Eupholimus, who went ambassador.
Eupholimus,
who went ambassador to Rome for an amity, aid.
You know, money, aid. He took away. Okay.
And putting down the governments, which were according to the law. He brought new customs against the law.
See, he put down the government. He put the Israelite government down according to the Bible. And he brought the Greek government over it. Now, this is one of our wicked-ass Israelite brothers, Israelite forefathers who did this. Begging the Greeks for money so that they could set up gyms and get the young men working out in the gym. And working in the Greek fashion. Okay, come on, let's continue on.
For he built gladly a place of exercise under the tower itself, and brought the chief young men under his subjection, and made them wear a hat.
Okay, so they had this old Greek hat that they had them put on, with the wings on them, made them wear that hat, and made it got all the chief young men. What do you think he's talking about?
Sports.
All the chief young men. We ain't talking about the short, wimpy guys. They talking about all of the big, bulky, big guy, athletic type Israelites. And got them in the gym. Start working them out. Made them put on a hat. All right, come on.
Now such was the height of Greek fashion.
Oh, the height of Greek fashion. Let's see what the Greek fashion.
And increase of heathenish manners.
All the heathenish manners from the Greek increase.
Through the exceeding profaneness of Jason. That ungodly wretch.
Okay, his profaneness increased all of that. So he didn't care about the Most High God. Let's come on.
And no high priest. That the priests had no courage to serve anymore at the altar.
They didn't want to serve at the altar. Let's see what they did.
But despising the temple and neglecting the sacrifices.
They hated the temple and neglecting the sacrifices. Let's see what they did.
Hastened to be partakers of the unlawful allowance.
They hastened to be partakers of the money, women, and fame. That's what these games are. These games still go on, and that's what they give you. Money, women, and fame. Come on.
In the place of exercise, after the game of discus.
That's what that was the NFL during this time. That was the NBA during this time. That was the Major League Baseball during this time. This was the sport that everybody wanted to get into for money, women, and fame.
Not setting by the honors of their fathers.
Not setting by the honor of the father, keeping the commandments, doing the service of the Most High God.
But liking the glory of the Grecians best of all.
They like the Grecians. Don't we do that now? These scriptures here fit today.
By reason whereof sore calamity came upon them, for they had them to be their enemies and avengers.
This is what we do right now. We call our enemies to avenge us for them killing us. This in the Bible. This is what they did back then.
Whose custom they followed so earnestly, and unto whom they desire to be like in all things.
Oh, God, slap me hard. This is what we do right now. We want to be just like them. We try hard to be just like the Edomites, be just like Grecians. In all things. They get blonde hair, you get blonde hair. They get a they start being homosexuals. Shoot, well, I'm talking, we some of the worst homosexuals out there. You know, because, you know, a black homosexual, you know, white homosexuals, you know, they're gay. Black homosexual, man, you just like, damn, won't you go so, you are not a woman. They try to outdo women. Excuse the expression, but that's us. You know, it's like, man, you know, you see an Israelite homosexual, you see white homosexuals, you know, they're just homosexuals. But, you know, black homosexuals, they take the snap, crackle, and pop to another doggone box of cereal. I'll tell you. Cause they get, I'm like, there, you know, there should be some homosexual rules. Like, look, you ain't got to act like no woman. We know you're not a woman. Unless you change it to one, but you're not a woman. You over-exaggerate yourself. Okay, let us finish up our lesson. All right, let's get Jeremiah 17. I just wanted to bring that out because there's nothing new under the sun. Y'all, you know, I'm going to tell you, y'all don't understand why the Most High God terrorizes us, because this is the stuff that we do. We forsook him.
Jeremiah what?
17:15-27. No, I'm not going to go there.
So
17:15-27,
like you said
it.
Oh, that's a lot to do, Alex.
And y'all wonder why the Most High God got a problem with us. Why he terrorizes us on a regular daily basis. And why he laughs at our calamity. I'm angry because he angry. All right, 15 through what I said, 27? All right, Alex, read it.
Behold, they say unto me, where is the word of the Lord? Let it come now.
Yeah, where the word of the Lord? Let it come. Come on.
As for me, I am not hastened from being a pastor to follow thee. Neither have I desired the woeful day. Thou knowest that which came out of my lips was right before thee. Be not a terror unto me. Thou art my hope in the day of evil. Let them be confounded that persecute me, but let not me be confounded. Let them be dismayed, but let not me be dismayed. Bring upon them the day of evil, and destroy them with double destruction.
You know, that is a prayer that, I want to have, because if I'm preaching this word of the Most High God to y'all, and when the day of evil come, and not that evil come up on me, Lord, because I'm doing your will, trying to do your work or whatever, but, you know, they ain't listening, and they trying to persecute me, because you know what, I'm going to tell you, you get in this truth, prepare to lose all your friends. Well, some of them will stick around, but, you know, prepare to lose the majority of them. It's cool with me, because you know what? I'd rather be in it for the Most High than for some, you know, some friendships that, you know, I don't know if they friends or not, friends or foe. If you're not following the laws of the Most High God, that's, you know, that's who I choose to follow. So, if you want to stay in the world, fine. You know, like I'm saying, I can't follow you there. All right, come on. Come on.
Thus said the Lord unto me, go and stand in the gate of the children of the people, whereby the kings of Judah come in, and by the which they go out, and all the gates of Jerusalem, and say unto them, hear ye the word of the Lord.
Y'all hear the word of the Most High God. He said, stand at the gate of for the king, where the kings of Judah come in and come out. And he said, hear the word of the Lord. Let's see if they listen. Come on.
Ye kings of Judah, and ye all Judah, and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem that enter in by these gates. Thus saith the Lord, take heed to yourselves, and bear no burden on the Sabbath day, nor bring it in by the gates of Jerusalem.
Okay, now, y'all understood what he just said. Take heed to the Sabbath day. Don't be doing no work on the Sabbath day. We're doing that now. We tell people, you know, you can tell people, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. You know, Exodus 20:8. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. They ain't going to remember the Sabbath day. They're going to be wanting to do everything, include mow their lawn, wash their car, do all kind of stuff. Go shopping and everything. Take heed to yourself. Come on. Come on.
Okay. Neither carry forth the burden out of your houses on the Sabbath day, neither do ye any work, but hallow ye the Sabbath day, as I commanded your fathers. But they obey not, neither incline their ear.
Man, get on out of my face. Nobody want to hear what you got. I'm taking this stuff because I got to sell it down to Jim Bob down the street, and I need to move it out while I got the help. And the help came today, so I need this stuff moved out, and me and Jim Bob are going to make a transaction. So,
the major next did, that they might not hear.
They ain't want to hear.
Nor receive instruction. And it shall come to pass, if ye diligently hearken unto me, saith the Lord, to bring in no burden through the gates of the city on the Sabbath day, but hallow the Sabbath day, to do no work therein, then shall there enter into the gates of the cities in the city kings and princes sitting upon the throne of David, riding in chariots and on horses, they and their princes, the men of Judah, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and the city shall remain forever. And they shall come from the cities of Judah, and from the places about Jerusalem, and from the land of Benjamin, and from the plain, and from the mountains, and from the south, bringing burnt offerings, and sacrifices, and meat offerings, and incense, and bring sacrifices of praise unto the house of the Lord. But if ye will not hearken unto me to hallow the Sabbath day, and not to bear a burden, even entering in at the gates of Jerusalem on the Sabbath day, then I will kindle fire in the gates thereof, and it shall devour the palaces of Jerusalem, and it shall not be quenched.
Now, with that said, we would even keep the Sabbath day. Jeremiah is pleading with them, thus said the Lord. And the kings of Judah, none of them wouldn't hearken to him. So, verse 27 again, Alex.
But if ye will not hearken unto me to hallow the Sabbath day, and not to bear a burden, even entering in at the gates of Jerusalem on the Sabbath day, then will I kindle fire in the gates thereof, and it will, and it shall devour the palaces of Jerusalem, and it shall not be quenched.
So I'm going to destroy it altogether, and my fire won't quench. You're not coming back to it. I'm going to destroy it this time, because if you can't keep my commandments, you're not obeying me. You will violate my Sabbath day. You're breaking my covenant. Like he said in Leviticus 26. So if you despise my statutes, if your soul abhor my, let me see, 14. But if ye would not hearken unto me and would not do all these commandments, and if ye shall despise my statutes, or if your soul abhor my judgments, we do that right now. So that ye will not do all my commandments, but that you break my covenant, I will do this to you. I'm going to do this to you. I will even appoint over you terror. I'm going to appoint over you terror. So, when you read into these books, understand these scriptures, Jeremiah was telling them, and they didn't want to hearken. And what he said, I'm going to burn it down and you're not going back in there then. That's terror. If you don't want to do what I say, do. Okay. I'm going to burn this whole city down. I told you not to bring nothing out the gates or in the gates on the Sabbath day. Now, if you don't want to listen to me, I'm burning this thing down and it's not going to get quenched. And when them kings and leaders and all the children of Israel came in on them damn slave ships, crying and praying and we sorry, we wrong, we did this. They knew the name of the Most High God, but they wasn't doing his commandments then. And all the stuff that they went through, we ain't like they don't deserve it. We deserve everything we got because the Most High God in this book was telling us, if you didn't want to do what I told you to do, I'm going to point over you terror. Now, since he has terrorized us, allowed us to be terrorized from then until now, you guys got to come back to the Most High. You got to repent. I can't end my lesson without telling you how to repent. You know, because if I just ended my lesson right here, and I'll just sound like an angry Israelite. I want you guys to understand how to repent. Because the Most High God wants you to come back, return to him. That's why he's terrorizing you. You know, if he hadn't killed you, he's trying to wake you up. All right, come on. Let's get 1 Kings.
8:46-49.
All right, go ahead and read it.
If they sin against thee.
If you sin against the Most High, come on.
For there is no man that sinneth not.
It ain't nobody that walked this earth pure of sin.
And thou be angry with them, and deliver them to the enemy, so that they carry them away captives unto the land of the enemy.
Okay, that's exactly what happened. He delivered us to the enemy, and they carried us away in them slave ships captives.
Far or near.
And we went far. Most of us went far. And some of us went near too. Come on.
Yet, if they shall bethink themselves in the land whither they were carried captives.
Bethink. If you remember who you are.
And repent.
And repent. Return.
And make supplication unto thee in the land of them that carried them captives.
Okay, when you make supplication, just be listen carefully to how you make supplication. Because you just can't make supplication and start talking about, I ask God to forgive me. No. Come on.
Saying, we have sinned and have done perversely.
We done perversely. Most, you know, not just sinning. You got to tell him all your perverseness. Oh, I violated the Sabbath day. I've been a fornicator. I've been a whoremonger. You know, I've been thievery. I've been a liar. I'm sorry. You know, I didn't know that I didn't know. I've been eating pork and shrimp, crab and lobster. I've been violating all your covenants. Come on.
We have committed wickedness.
We committed wickedness. We celebrating Christmas. We celebrating Easter, Thanksgiving, 4th of July. We sorry. We celebrating birthdays.
And so, return unto thee with all their heart and with all their soul in the land of their enemies, which led them away captive, and pray unto thee toward their land.
Where's your land?
Jerusalem.
Says who?
The Bible.
Okay, what verse and chapter? Chapter and verse.
13?
No.
13, what? Let's see. I want to think Gander and say...
Matthew.
No. Leviticus. No. Galatians.
13.
No, there ain't no 13 in Galatians.
5 and 13.
4. 26. I don't know why you kept trying to put 13 in there.
26 is the multiple of 13.
Okay. All right, read that. Who there?
I am. Right, Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all.
Jerusalem is the motherland of all of us. That's where the Garden of Eden was. So Jerusalem is our motherland. That's the land that the Most High God gave us, and he named it City of Peace. Okay, come on.
Which thou gavest unto their fathers.
He gave to our fathers.
The city which thou hast chosen, and the house which I have built for thy name.
So Solomon, this is Solomon's prayer. He built that house for the Most High God's name. He didn't want King David, because King David was a warrior. So he said King David's hands was too bloody.
Then hear thou their prayer and their supplication in heaven, thy dwelling place, and maintain their cause.
So that's when the Most High God maintain your cause. When you return, repent, start keeping his commandment. Because repent, you return him back to the law. And you start keeping the commandments. But you got to make supplication before you start praying. And we know that the Most High God don't hear sinners. If you're in sin, he hates you. If you're walking around out of order, women, you know, women in dresses, women in pants, men in dresses, you know, he's not listening to all of that. You know, men out of order because they don't shave. They go shave their beard every day. Looking like a boy. And that white man called you. He didn't want you to put a beard on. He wanted you shaving every day. So you look like a boy. 100-year-old boy. Boy, come here. So, you know, understand how to be men of the Most High. You got to make supplication and tell the Most High, you know, we sorry. Because you know what? I didn't know that, you know, Christmas felt good to me when I was growing up. You know, it just was a time of year that it made everybody feel good. Not realizing that was built in wickedness. You know, we just got to make supplication. So I want you guys to repent. You know, get this terror off of you. Aren't you tired of being terrorized every day? Aren't you tired of your community being terrorized? You got to answer that question for yourself. Because most of y'all have closed your eyes and accepted the terrorism that you're getting. Okay, so with that, hope you guys got some edification out of that. With that, I'm going to say shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom.